So listen, y'all, we just went through some bullshit on the show. Y'all not going to get a full show on the visual side over here on YouTube, but we've been potting for like an hour now, but the fucking,
I'm sick of this.
Yeah, I'm a dickhead. The interface memory card was full, and I took a look at it because, as you guys know, I talk about it. I do all the audio and visual engineering here, and I looked down in it. The shit said zero because I want to know, like, how long have we been potting? We was going for like 45 minutes, and it's fire. So the audio is going to be a little off. Well, it's going to be camera audio, so it's going to be echoey, but still audio nevertheless. So this fresh audio is going to be for the listeners on the, just the listeners, but the viewers will get two separate audios, and this is where you're picking up from the viewers. I forgot what we was talking about. We was cooking, but let's get back to the viewership. So welcome back to episode 219 of the All Jokes Aside podcast. I'm your host, Will Mills, a.k.a. King Dirtbag. Ray's out. She's sick. She's not feeling well. We did all this already. She'll be back next week. And also, you guys know,
407 Kevin's in the house.
Yeah, Pooh Bear, Winnie the Pooh. Oh, we agreed not to do that anymore.
Orlando Calrissian, nigga.
Motherfucking, I'm doing just fine. Let's not wait till the water runs dry. It's in the building. You know what I mean? What's another good one they got?
Four Seasons of Loneliness.
Four Seasons of Loneliness with the all white on. That's a fire video, son. You know what's so funny about that Four Seasons of Loneliness shit? They was together.
Yo, you know what? We've been talking about this. Yo, Lark Voorhees is in every video, dog. She was in One Bended Knee with Boyz II Men. She was in the Def Jam's How to Be a Player. She was his girl. She was Shorty and Drew Hill. You remember the one where they had the Man in the Iron Mask and Cisco with both niggas? Lark Voorhees. It's his girl.
Lark, I mean, if it wasn't her, because
Lark was the baddie in the 90s. She's rough now.
Well, nigga.
She looked rough now.
Well, I think she's sick.
Yeah.
I think she's sick.
Yeah. They brought her back for the Saved by the Bell reunion, and they got her looking good. No, she looked good again.
Because it was her, for me, in the 90s, because it was always like, it was weird what black people was doing, son. What white people were doing. They wanted them dark-skinned, but still ethnic-looking.
Yeah.
Because you had Lark, you had Ashley from Saved by the Bell, and then I'm Saved by the Bell, from Fresh Prince, and then you had
Gabrielle Union.
No, Stacey Dash.
Oh, Stacey Dash, yeah.
You see what I'm saying? They was like dark skin, but they still had like the real curly hair, like look Indian kind of like mixed.
Yeah.
Dark skin mixed chicks was like the top of the food, but I wish we can go back to a time when we could darken up our women again, because the list never ends. Like, I mean, you had Nia Long, you had Young Megan Good, you had Gabby, you had Sanaa Lathan, you had Jada.
You considering Sanaa Lathan a dark skinned girl?
She's darker. She's not high yellow like fucking Lisa Ray.
Yeah. I mean, but Nia Long, I'll put her in the light skin category.
They're not light skin. They like brown skin. They're not dark skin. They're definitely not. Damn. There weren't many dark skin beauties that were on display back then. I mean, there was some dark skin beauty. Like, here's a dark one, but still had that Indian mixed look to her.
Hold on. Can I guess what you're about to say?
Yeah.
Fancy from the Jamie Foxx show?
No.
Because she's
Garcelle Bouvard?
Yeah, not her.
Okay. But she's a baddie.
Yeah.
She wound up getting caught up on drugs.
Damn.
No, the girl I'm talking about.
Oh.
Nia. Oh, the fuck was her name, man? Oh, shit. She was on In the House with LL Cool J.
Oh, I know who you're talking
about. Mia Campbell.
Maya Campbell. Yeah. Maya
Campbell. Baddie.
Yeah.
But she was like, she looked like kind of like that. She had like that Chili from TLC look to her.
Yeah. Oh, Chili's another one.
Chili, but
very, very Indian looking. Like black, but with the Indian features.
So they wanted them a little darker, but now it's like high yellow, almost white passing is like what they want now.
Yeah, we don't really have like black girls in the. I feel like most of the black girls that we champion are like light skinned black girls.
What
like,
I will say like though,
Zendaya.
I can I say something?
Yeah,
she looks like a little girl to me. Like she doesn't do it for me.
I mean, you're also like 50, nigga.
I'm not 50. Zendaya is what 25, 26, 27.
Yeah, she's, yeah.
Nigga, that's my age range. The fuck, son.
I don't know. Like,
what you mean?
Age range is
I'm
crazy.
Early 40s.
Oh, you're... Nah, I don't know.
20, I'm 43, bro.
That's like a 20-year age difference. That's not a little... That's
no.
I bet.
No, nigga. I'm not 60, nigga. Like, all right. Put it like this. I say for me, where it doesn't look creepy, mm-hmm. is like 27 and up.
Okay.
Yeah, I think she's around that age.
She's just a Disney Channel kid. She grew up on Disney Channel, so it would be weird.
Yeah, no. I don't see her. Like, she looks like my daughter. Like, yeah. I would, like she's like somebody I would raise.
Yeah.
But not because of the way, it's her body. She's fucking got a boy body.
I mean, she plays Mary Jane in Spider-Man. She's a teenager.
But I don't like how they try to make her, like, she's not sexy, bro.
Yeah. My mans loves her. I mean, depending on what you see her in.
No.
She does have sex appeal.
She's beautiful.
Did you watch the tennis movie where she was getting ran through?
I heard it. I wanted to.
I didn't watch it.
Partners or Swingers.
I don't
Swingers
know what it was called. Or, I just know it was the tennis
movie where she got ran through. Yeah, and the niggas, yeah, Thruples, or something like that. Like, there are some younger girls that you look at them and be like, God.
I don't even know any of the celebrity baddies anymore. I don't know who anybody is.
Because they ain't on movies no more. They on Instagram.
Yeah, I don't keep up with people on Instagram.
Like, here's one. Nigga, India Love? Jesus Christ.
I got to look her up. I don't know who that is.
Her host, nigga. I'll pull it right. India Love, nigga. Even her sisters.
Nah, I don't know India Love like that.
Nigga, India Love is...
You was getting some Four Rivers earlier?
Oh, no. Well, last week I did.
Oh, okay. I love Four Rivers.
Yeah, India Love, nigga. Hold on. India Love.
You know who I like? I like Janelle Monáe.
I love Janelle Monáe. I don't like how she plays with being gay, though. Is she gay or not, nigga?
She could be bi.
Damn.
I love that she had like a whole summer with her titties out.
Great hits, bro.
Yeah, her titties was out. Oh, yo, I love this girl. This girl's very... India Love. She has a very strong, like, face.
India Love. Nigga, but you know, there's five of them, right? It's five of them.
Is it Lotto, Ice Spice?
No. It's five sisters.
They all look... She looks like Lotto.
She's my, but the sister is my favorite. Look at her sister. Crystal.
Love?
Crystal Westbrook.
Mm.
So it's the Westbrook sisters. They actually had a show briefly on BET.
Are they related to Russell?
No.
Okay.
Crystal Westbrook. Maybe they're from LA. He from LA. Crystal Westbrook. And they all got real big, real titties.
I know. I love that.
That's the sister right there.
Oh, yeah. I've seen her on shit.
Yeah, that's her sister.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's Morgan and Bree. And they all got real big titties.
How do you know about these people? Like, how do you find out about people?
I just
2024.
Is that all of them? Look at that. Born in 1994, bro.
She's 30.
See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That creepy?
I don't know.
She's
born in
30 years old, bro.
I was born in 92.
That's perfect for me. But yeah, look at. I'm gonna show you all, and it's even a fat one.
Oh, word! Oh, give me that one.
That's them right there. See, that's the sisters. They all bad, bro.
What's the fat one's name?
This one right here. Look at her though. She's fucking gorgeous, bro.
Yeah, no, I like her.
They all gorgeous. Here they go. Here we go. Let's pull them up. Except whatever the fuck this is. Look at them. But this one right here is the badass. She's a badass.
Yeah, she's wearing sunglasses inside. No,
oh, no, no. That's not why she's the bad. I'm gonna show you something. She's probably the dopest one. Let me show you why. Let me show you something about that girl. Listen. Morgan Westbrook. She's fucking ill, son. Show you something about her, bro. She's a fucking baddie, my nigga. Look at this shit. MSP, money solve problems. Yeah, she's a fucking badass for real, son. That shit is sexy to me, bro.
I hate seeing that reckless.
What? Look at her, son.
Yeah, I don't like reckless.
That's sexy as fuck, bro. Like a nigga, she be standing up on the motorcycles and all that. That's a dope ass chick, my nigga.
I don't want to see that shit. If you fall off that shit and all your skin is ripped off, now you're not cute.
What
anymore.
A pussy.
Yeah, I don't like that shit at all. Don't do no reckless shit around me.
Let's get back into the show because we fucking already recorded for our, but, it's going to be easy editing for me. And we're behind. So, you know, I mean, if you're a listener, you've been getting all the episodes, but YouTube, we're behind on that. And that's my bad. Wilma's calling for what? What are these people be talking about? Okay.
Yo, we all over the place. We apologize if y'all watching.
Here's what I want to ask you, bro. Do you watch any podcasts?
Yeah, I watch the Joe Budden podcast.
Okay. If you ever wanted to find out how uninteresting women are, look to podcasts. I don't think there's a. I'm pretty sure there is. Let me put some context on it. I don't think there's a popular woman's podcast in existence where they're not talking about sex or men.
Mm. Yeah, what would they talk about?
You see? Women need men to in order to be interesting.
Right? What about like murder podcasts where they talk about like...
That's why I said popular.
Ah, but you...
That's niche. So there's fans on that one. But I mean popular. Like, shit you see popping up on social media and the women who have some notoriety.
Could that be a trend of society, though? Like, society is not going to make a podcast popular unless it's about what they want to hear?
That's not true because Joe Rogan is. Joe Budden is.
Mm-hmm.
Charlamagne and them is. Drink Champs is.
Yeah, but also I think...
And none of those talk about fucking relationships.
Do you believe in the patriarchy?
No, I just think women ain't... All right, watch this. I'm going to give you something, right? So women think that men don't watch basketball because it's women playing. We don't watch women's basketball because they suck.
Right.
Men looks better.
Yeah.
And then they say, oh, you're saying it's because she's a woman. I'm like, okay, well, let's take it to another sport. I don't watch men's gymnastics. I watch women's gymnastics because women's gymnastics are better than men's gymnastics.
Yeah.
I have no interest in watching the fucking pommel horse, nigga.
I just want to watch the best of the best.
But I watch them, and that's what it's all about. Women want to make it gender things, but it's not gender. Y'all suck. Now, if they lowered the basketball rim up to about 8 feet, mm-hmm. and women was windmilling and dunking like LeBron in them,
yeah.
Nigga, I'm watching that.
Yeah. Wasn't there like a outburst of people watching WNBA and college women's basketball because of like Caitlin Clark and shit?
And why?
Because... They was out here like shooting threes.
No,
and
why? Because she's good.
Yeah, she's really good.
She's good. Why did we start watching tennis?
To Venus and
because of Venus and right. If you're good, we will. Nigga, yeah. Fuck, nigga. They made a nation of people interested in a sport that we never watched.
Mm-hmm.
We watched golf because of Tiger Woods. So it's not. Yeah. It got nothing to do with gender. Be good at it, and we'll support you.
Are you kind of cutting women's feet from under them by saying that they can't talk about men or sex though? Because, like, horrible decisions, right? Or, like, the other women-led podcast.
What I'm saying is that's all they talk about.
Mm-hmm.
That's all they talk about. It's not interesting if they...
Would you be interested if it was about anything else? Like, if women were just talking about the shit that they like, I don't think that it would catch a man's attention because we'd be like, I don't know what the fuck about
They've never tried it. All right, so look. Joe Budden runs a podcast and they mainly talk about music. You mean to tell me there's no women who's, like, knowledgeable on music?
No, oh, okay.
They haven't tried it. They're just shooting for the fucking low-hanging fruit.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
They're not even
trying to be interesting. They're just following the trends.
What are, the top podcasts in the world? I don't even know.
Joe Rogan is the number one podcast in the world. And his shit is
Tucker
the most...
Tucker Carlson, I think, just recently beat him out as the number one, for, like, a short
but Joe, time. But Joe Rogan is the quintessential podcast. Mm-hmm. Is what... Who I view as our possible competition in the near future. It's the most random. It's just random.
Yeah.
It's interesting. He's talking about science and he's talking about the mother. What he's not talking about is fucking sex, bro. Like,
right.
He's talking about religion, UFOs. He got rappers on it sometimes, comedians on it. Yeah. It's just all over the place.
He got but Terrence Howard talking about fucking string theory.
It's just
and shit.
Fucking interesting, bro. It's mm-hmm. interesting. It's yeah. always interesting.
Yeah.
And what I'm saying to women is, if you want men or society to pay attention to what you're doing, be interesting. And I'm saying you can't be interesting without men.
Mm.
Prove me wrong.
I feel like that's a paradox. Like, you want them to be interesting, but you won't let them be interesting.
No, they're not even doing... I know what I'm saying? That's why I asked the question.
Yeah.
If it exists, I'll be glad to apologize, bro.
Right. I think a lot of that has to do with the patriarchy. Like,
what?
Like, we won't let women have another conversation. Just, like, the same reason why all the female rappers all talk about their pussies and, like, fucking is because, like, we only want one thing. Like, a rap city is out here rapping about other shit, but she doesn't have no type of global radio play because people don't flock to that. People don't celebrate that. They don't champion that.
That's not true. Okay. Nothing gets men's legs, nothing gets men moving more than appealing to our primal instincts, which is sex,
mm-hmm.
right? That's why OnlyFans exists. This is why women get BBLs. It has nothing to do with men.
Mm-hmm.
They think we like that shit. No, we like to fuck. Mm-hmm. Right? But nobody's marrying these BBL bitches. Like, nobody's, niggas ain't, you'll see them fucking them. Listen, I remember there was a time where it was a shameful thing to be a stripper. Yeah. If you ever seen Players Club,
yeah,
she was ashamed of it. She wasn't proud of being a stripper, bro.
Right.
She was in college, and she was ashamed of what she did. When she saw her teacher, she ran. And if they wrote that movie this year, bro, she's happy to do it.
They did. It was called Hustlers, and they were real proud about it. Cardi B was
and Lizzo was in it.
Lizzo
was the fat stripper. She was the comic relief.
Yeah, I think she had a cameo. Yeah.
No, she was a character.
Well,
Lizzo had her titties out.
I don't remember. Jennifer Lopez was in it too.
Jennifer Lopez was like the fucking madam.
And it
sucked, by the way. It was trash.
Because it was all about stealing money from niggas. It was like finessing niggas.
It's like, what can I put like this? Look at the irony here in the shit women do, right? So you want to be loved, you want to be courted, but you're doing things to make yourself
less desirable and less likely to be married.
That and more independent to not need a man.
Yeah.
So you're creating a fail-safe for yourself to where you don't need men by exposing yourself to get the money, mm-hmm. and then after all that's said and done, marry me. No.
Yeah, and it's poor foresight because you're going to get your looks are going to fade with time, and eventually you're going to want to have somebody to be there for you.
Bro.
And then you don't have that anymore because niggas are just looking at you like you've been ran through. And
right.
Like,
and I think the late great, I think Kevin Samuels probably said this. I heard somebody say it years ago and I loved it. Said, and I hate to throw my own women under the bus. He said, white women go to college to find a husband. Black women go to college so they won't need one.
Yeah, I think that was Kevin. Yep.
Bro, I mean, it's not even, and then somebody will take this bit and say, oh, you're being, you're going against your own. We don't base things on these things on emotion, bro. Like, I'm not.
It's logic.
It's logic. I'm not dissing black women. I mean, if you want me to think different, do something different. Like you said, there's a patriarchy with this podcast and shit and things of the day, right? It's not, because I bought this studio. Horrible Decisions, shout out to Mandy and I'm doing a thing over there. And Weezy, Mandy and Weezy doing a thing on Horrible Decisions. Weezy own that podcast studio. Mm-hmm. They're flourishing. Granted, the content is sex-based and men-based, but that's what they do.
Yeah.
They set the ground of what the female podcast looks like. You got lipstick with the lipstick shit with Angela Yee. Mm-hmm. But it's all shit. Talk about fucking and sex, and mm-hmm. that's what it's all about.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is, can women be interesting without doing that? I don't think so. And if you don't want me to prove me wrong. Prove me wrong, son.
I feel like I have a counter argument to this, but I don't have enough research to say if it's true or not. But I feel what happened, if that does take place, if a woman makes a podcast outside of sex or men, is that other women are going to be the target audience, and it doesn't have enough staying power if just women are watching it. You need to also appeal to men, and men don't give a fuck about what women are doing. Like, we don't care about your hobbies and shit. Like, your hobbies, if it's like, and we want to do our own hobbies and shit. It's not like we're trying to shit on you. It's just like, yo, all right, what we really want in an ideal world is you go do your own hobbies and I'll go do my own hobbies.
I think that's gaslighting.
Is that gaslighting?
I think you're gaslighting. Yeah, you know, I do, because the thing about it is,
educate me, because I don't want to be a gaslighter.
No. I think that's, sorry, not you. I think that's a woman's way of gaslighting, by just already writing us off as, oh, you're not going to be interested anyway. It's like, you haven't even attempted it. Like spark, like, for instance, like I said, Joe Budden and them have a music podcast.
Oh, if there's so you're a group asking of women to do exactly what men are already doing.
Right, because they say they can. Mm. So prove me wrong. I'm saying your podcast would fucking suck if you wasn't talking about pussy and fucking all the time.
So would you?
It would suck.
Would you consider a woman credible if she was out here, like, just talking about, giving her insight about like hip hop and shit?
Bro, if she's knowledgeable, she's knowledgeable. Mm. Fuck that. Like, if she knows what she's talking about, there's female personalities on some of these male-led podcasts, like on ESPN. Mm-hmm. Bro, I listen to Molly. I listen to her, bro.
Yeah.
She knows what the fuck she's talking about.
When Angela Yee was on the Breakfast Club.
Angela Yee, but also her.
Angie.
She had, like, the rumor report.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's something that people look forward to.
Yeah, 100%.
And that was her shit. Like,
but if it's a female-led.
That's what I'm saying. If it's a female-led thing, like, I think this old, this thing where men are not interested, and it's like, we don't watch the women's, now granted, the most of the gymnasts, granted, I'll fuck each and every one of them, but they're not that, they're not like, oh my gosh, she got a fat ass, and no, what they're doing is incredible. Like, the male gymnasts are more agile than the female gymnasts because they're men. Mm-hmm. But we don't have any interest in the men. The men mostly suck, bro.
I've never even seen male gymnastics.
Can you name a male gymnastic in existence over the course of history? Can you name one?
That's not a fair argument for me because I can't name a female gymnast.
Yes, you can. You can name Gabby Douglas, Simone Biles. Even if you don't watch it, you heard their name before.
I've heard Simone Biles. I thought she was a track star.
Oh, no. No, what about Gabby Douglas?
Never heard of her.
This girl is on fire. She's the girl on fire.
Oh, I thought that was Alicia Keys.
That's her song, but it was about Gabby Douglas.
Okay, I didn't know.
Like, these girls are amazing, bro.
I thought Simone Biles broke the record for being the fastest bitch of all time.
No.
Who was that? That was another girl?
Recently?
Yeah, these
That's Shikari.
Oh, Richardson. Yeah. She's Jamaican or some shit?
She's American.
Oh, these black girls are really doing it.
These black, and I'm saying, like, black women have the power. Because they are incredible beings, and they have the power. It's like, yo.
Out of sight, out of mind, though.
Spark my fucking interest in something. It gets oversaturated. And then when they get on podcasts with men, they get dominated. Like,
yeah. I hate hearing Melissa Ford on the Joe Budden podcast. I hate hearing
She doesn't her add any value to me.
She doesn't add any value to the show.
She doesn't add no value to me. Yeah. I think Joe did her a favor.
Yeah, and like, she's up there. Worst case scenario, she's just asking questions because she doesn't want to have any hot takes. She doesn't want to stand behind anything salacious.
Right.
And then whenever she does say something that's like a strong point, niggas just back her down.
Right.
Back her down every time. So she just
And then sometimes water. She gets herself in hot water.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Cam was pissed.
Yeah, she got herself in hot water. Again. Yeah.
The one time that she tried to have a hot take, she basically showed why she shouldn't talk.
Right. Yeah. So what I'm saying is, like, I'm not saying women can't be great at it.
Yeah.
But prove me wrong. Like, if I'm making a statement based off a fact, prove me wrong.
I just don't want to sound ignorant because I don't know what female podcasters
and
are.
And I don't want to either, but I'm just saying, like, as a podcaster,
sound off in the comments. If y'all watch a female right, podcast,
that doesn't have anything to do
with men or sex.
With men or sex or your pussy or relationships. Mm-hmm. And it's just something outside of that. Even if it's a niche one. Because I know my daughter listens to one. And it's a like a murder mystery joint.
Yeah.
But that's a niche one.
They love
one.
That one. Yeah, they love
and
the murder mystery
those joint. Do very well.
Yeah.
Those do very well.
Honestly, I don't know enough about podcasts.
Because those are more of an audio
yeah. experience. Yeah. Bro, I'm the same way with comedy. I don't watch a lot of comedy shows because I do the shit. So it doesn't, like, it feels like I'm peeking behind the curtains. It's like I know how magic
Bro,
works.
Somebody put up some shit. I forgot his name. I don't want to say his name. He said some shit in the comedy group. Mm. He said that comedians should stay
and watch each other at the open mic.
What the nigga? You sound like an open micer, nigga.
Yeah, that sounds
the
like
the fuck out of here. Let me tell you something, comedians.
That sounds like
and that
shit.
Nigga, whoever said that. Let me tell you something, dickhead. I'm not there to watch other comedians. I'm there to do my shit and get the fuck out of there and possibly make it to another mic so I can rework that same material somewhere else. I'm not there to fuck it. Nigga, this is not a team sport. Mm-hmm. I talked about this before, son. Bro, Kev is my nigga. That's my friend.
Yes.
At the end of the day, I understand me and Kev got, we know this. I have a fan base. He has a fan base. We do two completely different types of comedy.
100%.
I can't steal Kev's fans. He can add some of my fans onto his fan base.
Sure.
But there's not going to be people to say, oh, Kev's funny, and then see me and be like, oh, Kev's not funny anymore.
Right.
That's not how it works.
No.
And this shit is not a team sport. And, like, we all trying to do this shit and make it, bro. Mm-hmm. So this is not no kumbaya open micers.
What niggas are really saying is, yo, when I go to the open mic, nobody watches my set. And if all the comics just came inside, we'd have a full audience. Nigga, I'm not trying to hear your 5 minutes of mid. And we've all heard your bullshit.
And the open mic, my bad. It ain't Unico, what Kevin does. It ain't what Jari does. And, shout out to him on Wall Street or a Chronic Guru. It ain't those, right? Your open mic you're doing sucks.
Yeah.
There's some open mic spots that produce an actual audience that comics are more happy to go to. I'm not going to no motherfucking Falcon hosted by Blake, nigga. I'm not going to that bullshit. So you know, nigga, I should go there to get a drink, nigga. I ain't never performed. Nigga, let me tell you something. I had an argument with my boys the other night, and they were telling me, like, yo, your social media is so viral and it's so lit that you should probably just focus on that and, like, don't do stand-up. I'm like, nigga, what?
Yeah, no.
No, stand-up is, that's my baby. Like, that's why I do social media.
Yeah.
Now, granted, people have easier access to me on social media because it's right there. My page is open. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I'm viral on different platforms. But, nigga, that social media shit could get shut down at any given moment.
Yeah, you don't own that platform.
I don't own it.
Instagram could just say fuck you and delete your account. I think that did happen to you before.
Yes, and I had to build it back up from scratch.
Yeah.
I got canceled before.
There's nothing guaranteed about this. And stand up, you control your own narrative.
And there's no greater feeling than being on that stage and they screaming your name and you're making people laugh. And after the show, people are hugging you and taking pictures. That shit feels amazing to me, bro.
My shorty just asked me today. She was like, I don't understand how you could work a 9-to-5 job and then get off, go work out, shoot your podcast, and then run and go do an event. How are you not tired at your shows? I'm like,
passion, bro.
I'm energized at my show. The show don't feel like work at all. The show, I do everything else so I could look forward to getting on stage afterwards. Granted, sometimes I don't like producing Onico, or I don't like having to put the show together.
Right.
I don't want to have to deal with getting an audience there every single week. That part is stressful. But the me being on stage part, like, yo, that's what I live for.
Nigga, let me tell you something. When I got a show coming up, especially if I'm headlining, bro,
mm-hmm.
nigga, my outfit, I'm like, what am I going to wear?
Mm-hmm.
I'm thinking about what song am I coming out to?
Yeah.
Like, all of these things are running through my mind. And that moment up until you hit that stage, you know that feeling, bro.
Yeah.
Like, especially when you out of town.
Mm-hmm.
That, fuck these in-town shows, because you know your friend's going to be there.
Yeah.
But, like, when we did Miami or when I did Vegas, bro, when you about to go on that stage, it's like game time. Like, nigga, that, it's not, it's, for me, there's no better feeling than that, bro. I'm going to go out here and I'm going to rock this shit, bro.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It take years to get to that moment. Like, it's no longer jitters to me. I know I have a habit of, and 11 years in, it happens to me every time. 2 minutes before I hit the stage, I forget my set. Every time, bro. Listen, it never fails. I don't know what the fuck. My set leaves my head, bro, and I don't remember it until I'm walking to the stage.
Yeah.
Sometimes I don't remember until I get the mic.
Yeah.
I forget it. My mind goes completely blank.
Yeah,
and this could be a set I've done dozens of times.
That's actually really common. It's because of flight or flight syndrome.
That shit is crazy to me.
Your body is releasing so much adrenaline. You're like, yo, I'm going to, everything that is not mandatory for me to survive right now is out the window. Because you're anxious about the show. Not that you're nervous or anything.
Right.
But your body naturally is telling you like, hey, yo, you're about to be in a fight.
Yep.
You're about to be in a fight. So, yo, get prepared. And then once you get on stage and you give the first what up to the crowd and everybody's clapping, your mind calms down. You're like, all right, now I know how I'm getting into it.
Bro, have you ever had a standing ovation yet?
Yeah.
Bro, that
is great.
I don't know if y'all watch, like, it's cool to listen, and I like that we're talking about this. I mean, we're not as seasoned. I mean, even me being 11 years, people are like, wow, that's a long time. I was like, nigga, that ain't shit, bro.
Yeah, yeah.
There's, when you
they're
got
11 years old,
when you got
comedy.
That's it. You're 11 years old. You got niggas like Corey Holcomb and Bill Burr. These guys, 30 years. These guys who've been doing it 40 years. Like, I'm a baby in this shit still.
Yeah, nigga, I'm 6, bro.
Like, nigga, I literally just headlined for the first time, like officially headlined last year. I mean, I've done shows where I closed.
Yeah.
But niggas say, oh, you're a headliner. Yeah, I headlined that show. Like, I'm not a headliner. Now I am.
Yeah.
But, like, unless you're doing, and I'm still a baby headliner. Like, I mean, I'll be real. Like, I can do an hour.
Yeah.
But a comfortable, but, like, a real headliner can do 3 hours, nigga.
Yeah.
You ever seen Godfrey?
Yeah.
Chappelle, these niggas could do.
He'll do, a 7 o'clock show and do an hour and a half and then do a 9 o'clock show a different hour and a half. All new material.
These niggas will do, there's things I've heard where some of them niggas be up there 3-4 hours, bro.
Mm-hmm.
3-4.
Well, Chappelle and Dane Cook have the record for longest time on stage. They both did the Laugh Factory. I think Dane Cook did it for like 16 hours, and then Chappelle.
What?
And then Chappelle went up there. I might be misquoting. It's a long time. Chappelle did it for 30 minutes longer. And then I think Dane Cook went one more time, and he brought everybody Burger King.
Here's some controversial shit, and I would love to see. Did you ever see what Corey said about Chappelle?
Yeah, I remember that.
When he said he bombs?
Yeah.
I heard a story about Richard Pryor. When he
fucking Marlon Brando? Because, yeah, that story's all
over. No, not that one.
I think
where he did a God bit and made the crowd cry.
What?
Bro, listen, you got to hear this shit, bro. I didn't hear the bit, but the way he said it, who was explaining it? I think it was Harry Mandel. Check this bit out he said that Richard Pryor did. That shit sounds like it. I wish I would have been, and this is in the 70s.
You know, I'm not as a comedian, I'm not a Richard Pryor nigga.
What?
I'm an Eddie Murphy. I'm an Eddie Murphy nigga. Yeah, I've watched a bunch of his specials.
Here's why I can't be an Eddie Murphy nigga. I think Eddie Murphy is just, he's like.
He's a student of Richard.
Right, but how good do you have to be to only have two specials that were released almost 40 years ago, and people still say your name when they talk about the GOAT? People don't understand. Eddie only did two specials. That's it.
Wrong. Yeah.
And that's almost 40 years ago, bro.
83 and 87.
That's it. He's never touched the stage again, bro.
Yeah.
And you still the GOAT?
Yeah. He's my GOAT. He's my greatest of all time.
And then you got to think about Eddie was 21, bro.
Yeah. So charismatic on stage. He could do it all.
He
does impressions. He does stories. But, he does quick one-liners.
Here's my controversial thing about Eddie. He was only 21. Right, so he didn't have a lot of life knowledge. Yeah. I believe, this is my belief. If Eddie didn't, if you remove Eddie's impressions, he sucks.
No.
I'm saying, what is the memorable things about him?
Eddie's take on relationships and women
what
is great.
I think it was mid.
No,
he
bro.
Still was doing impersonations.
No.
Everything was impersonations.
No, he was like, "Yo, when a woman gets cheated on enough, and then she goes to the Bahamas and finds another nigga,
right?" And he did the Jamaican dude's accent.
No. But just the whole story.
But I think if you remove the accents and the impressions out of it, it's not good comedy.
I'm not going to let you disrespect the GOAT like
that. I'm just saying. He didn't have much. Listen, Eddie, he's still GOATed.
Yeah.
But just for me, if you remove the, I mean, all of that ties into who he was.
There's so many other factors.
I just think that for me, that's what.
I feel like you're dismissing his whole. Yo, for a 21-year-old to have the insight that he has about, like,
family.
His crack. Like, when he talked about getting a cracker. Like, yo, if you haven't eaten in a long time, and then you get a Ritz cracker, you're like, oh, this is a good-ass cracker. Yo, why is this so good? Is this a saltine? Nigga, that's an amazing bit. Yeah, it's like, you had the same old pussy that you've been having.
You know, for me, and this is me giving, I may be giving him a little too much credit. I think that's who Preacher reminds people of.
Mm.
I think, bro, let me tell you something. Me and Preacher started a couple of years before me. Mm-hmm. So I brought him to Loud Hookah Lounge, right? And I think we talked about this.
Yeah, we talked about it.
And I used to have to follow spoken word. Spoken word is trash to me, mm-hmm. son. I hate that shit, bro. And it's so hard to make the transition from spoken word to comedy. And, bro, he would I hated it because he did it so much better. Because me, I'm an empath. Mm. So I'm following the energy in the room.
Yeah.
But he knew how to shift it.
Yeah.
And that's.
I actually also love doing comedy.
You can't teach people that. I like challenge. See, all right, so boom. Some people like that. I like hostile crowds.
Yeah.
Because I'm
you're
like.
You're adversarial. Your right, comedy is adversarial.
Right, play like this, right? I'm the other guy bar. I'm the other bar guy where there's hecklers. I'm a fucking New Yorker.
Yeah.
Right? So
you thrive in a show where everybody is kind of volatile.
Right.
They want to crack jokes. Right. Because now what they're doing, what they don't know, is that they're giving you a justification.
So much ammo, yeah.
They're giving you justification for you to be yourself.
Right.
Will Mills, the thing about you is if you start attacking the crowd and they didn't do anything to deserve it.
They pull back.
They pull back. They were like, yo, why are you coming so hard at us? We're not doing nothing.
Right.
But all you need is one person to be a dickhead in the crowd to be like, hey, what you got, nigga? Are you funny? Now your whole set is justified because I'm gonna be an asshole and you did this.
Right. So that's that's why my favorite comics are Bill Burr.
Yeah.
Louis C.K., Patrice O'Neill. Mm-hmm. These guys are New York guys. These are Northern guys. Like we thrive off hostile environments. Like you would fight in a New York crowd.
Yeah.
You would fight. Like you would fight to get that audience because they're funny too. Like they're also comedians.
Yeah.
Like I come from an environment where your environment was you were always the funniest guy.
Yeah.
Right? You know, you it was more calm.
Yeah.
I'm from the projects.
Everybody's a roaster.
Everybody's a roaster. Yeah. Everybody's funny. So I had to be the best of my whole environment being funny.
Yeah.
So it's like, this shit to me is a cakewalk. But also, I remember in Vegas, I dealt with a crowd like that at one of my shows out there. And after I got off stage, the dude was like, you from New York? I'm like, yeah. He's like, they're not ready for your type of comedy. Like, you got to go to another room.
Yeah.
And it happened to me in Vegas. Like, they were pulling back, they were offended, just off the context of my, and that's why I say me and you have two
100%.
Different styles of comedy.
Yeah,
there's some comics who knows how to walk the line. I can honestly say I haven't, and you know, don't book me for a clean comedy set.
Yeah,
I'm not willing to do it. I'm not funny in that state. Not to me anyway.
Yeah, and, it's not your style.
Other people may think like, oh nah, you was funny. Mm-hmm. I don't think I am. If I don't think I am, I'm not going to be funny.
Yeah.
But there's comics who know how to do that.
Yeah.
And there's one comic in particular who's great at that. I think it's Sean Madden. Mm. Sean Madden, he's underrated, bro. Sean Madden, Ross, and I say that for them is because black people, we dictate the funny. We have the roughest lives, and we've mastered turning our pain into laughter.
Yeah.
So when a white comic understands our culture and they don't look the part, they're going to be a beast, bro.
I feel like that's a easy layup for niggas like that.
Yeah, but they also still got to be funny.
Sure.
Because
sure.
Ross knows how to do it very well.
I feel like black audiences are so gentle with white comedians that come out. All we have to do is like...
But they know.
Know a little bit about the culture and don't try to assume you're a part of the culture. You come out there...
Which is the same reason we accept the Eminem.
Yeah.
Yeah, same thing.
Just like, hey, yo, I understand y'all struggle and I just want to let y'all know I struggle too. Not as much as you, but Dodge Charger. Boom. And then everybody in the audience is like, oh, shit, he gets us, nigga. Oh, hey, yo, I don't know about y'all, but I had to cook ramen noodles myself growing up.
It still doesn't make them funnier than us or more adept, but...
And I'm not talking shit. I think that's... I do the same shit on the other side.
The other comic who knows how to walk that line is Jari. Jari knows how to walk the line.
Yeah.
I think, of course, we all do better with white crowds. Like, white crowds fucking adore me, son. I'm a god to them,
It's
bro.
The same exact audience thing on the other side. All you have to do is not be too dangerous to them. Or if you are dangerous, be like, yo, I like y'all. Y'all the type of white people that I like. And then white people, they feel validated for the day.
I think, but you know
They're what? Like, oh, look, this black guy said he likes me.
Like, for instance, like a Tony Black, right? I don't think he would prefer, he would prefer to perform in front of a white audience.
I don't know.
No, a black audience. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I feel like he's more of a black comic.
I prefer white audiences.
I prefer a mixed crowd, but yeah.
No. If you ask me what's the easiest for me, white.
100%.
A white improv bonkers crowd, nigga.
If it's a white audience, I know I'm killing it. A black audience, I'm a little nervous. Because there's so many different types of black audiences.
Yes.
Every white audience is the same to me.
My worst show ever was in front of a southern black crowd, bro. First of all, I'm from New York, and I'm very New York. So
a Southern black crowd is completely different than a Northern New York crowd.
100%.
And there's a old black crowd. We're like, hey, yo, we like the oldies. We don't want to hear you say nigga too much in front of us. And then there's a young black crowd that's like, yo, we don't even know Tevin Campbell. Can we talk, right, nigga? Right, I'm 23 years old, nigga. I don't know shit.
And white people, I hate to say this. Once again, let me paraphrase, because I said this at the beginning. We come from laughter. Mm. We come from struggle. So everything is funny that we do. Mm-hmm. We laugh at the wildest shit, bro. Like, we have the best sense of humor. White people come to us for entertainment.
Yeah.
So it's like, and you got to walk, you got to, you know.
Because it can be shucking and jiving real quick. If
right.
Not careful.
And that's the thing. That's why I get on there and shit on white people. Like I'm like, I got more money than you. Like, I let them know, like, hey, listen, I'm not the guy. You know, I came here in a Range Rover. Like, yeah. I'm not gonna be up here dancing for you.
Yeah.
And
that's still a projection in itself.
But that type of black comic, I know some of those, and you know some of them very well too. Mm. Bro, I cannot stand, bro. If it's anything I hate, it's self. It's a new way of doing comedy.
Self-deprecating comics.
That's a thing, bro. Mm-hmm. And it's very popular.
It is.
Bro, I'm Adam Sandler. So I'm the hero of my story. You ever watch an Adam Sandler movie with him getting his ass whooped?
No.
Never.
Right.
Bro, I'm never.
There's something to it, though. It is. There's a psychology to an audience member like, yo, if I can laugh at myself, then you should be able to laugh at yourself. So I'm going to go first. I'm going to embarrass myself. And now for the rest of the time, y'all got to know, like, everything is off limits.
You don't self-deprecate either.
I don't do that. There's different styles of comedy. But also, I have a cheat code because I'm a likable person. So I'm going to go up there and be myself.
I think you're non-threatening.
Yeah.
I mean, you,
but non-threatening could be not funny real quick. Non-threatening
but it's only,
is,
it's, but,
is
but
corny
you know what though?
Fast.
That shit, but that's only with black people, though.
Mm-hmm.
Like, black crowds will do that to you.
Yeah.
They'll think you're a cornball. Like, yeah.
Well, if you're a non-threatening white, you're a self-deprecating white.
Right.
If you're non-threatening, then white people are going to let you know, hey, I know I look nerdy. I know I'm not cool, but.
That Gus shit.
Yeah. I'm not out here to shit on comedy. Yeah, shout out to Gus.
No, I love Gus, but that's what he does.
I mean, Gus got a couple different things in his bag, like a peanut butter and jelly sandwich.
See, I'm not saying that's. Gus, you got to stop that.
Gus got a couple different things in his bag.
Let's move along. Let's get into, I even hate to do this, bro. Speaking of self-deprecating, bro. Do you have any, I don't think you're into politics at all.
No.
But I saw something nasty. Nasty, bro. Like, first of all, if you look at the history of politics itself, right? Like, you know, it's election year, so I won't talk about it briefly. Republicans was always the party that was more progressive, right? Abraham Lincoln was a Republican.
Okay.
You know, at some point it changed, but I don't think the message changed ever. Mm. I think everybody's racist, first of all. I don't think they really give a fuck about black people, but I also think this day and age, black people, we really need to understand how fucking powerful we are. Mm-hmm. Because the level of pandering only to black people is crazy.
Yeah.
Like the people they're going to get. Trump already know, hey, rednecks, racist, I got y'all.
Hulk Hogan.
I don't got to convince y'all nothing. Mm-hmm. Hulk Hogan, Kid Rock. Like.
Yeah.
But then he got Kodak Black. Mm-hmm. Then the nigga got drill rappers. He got Chef G and Sleepy Hollow.
He got Wayne too.
No, he got these niggas talking at rallies.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Right?
He got Lil Pump talking.
Lil Pump.
Yeah.
Just, but in Trump's defense, right, he's always fucked with rappers.
He's always been
around
the culture.
He's a New York cat. He always fucked with rappers.
Always fuck with Trump. Everybody in the 90s have a Trump bar.
So they can get, like the narrative they're trying to spin about the racist shit, I don't like it, bro. I don't like it. It's nasty. It's low hanging fruit. Mm-hmm. So for people who are not hip to who Trump is, it's very easy. Once you put racism narratives in front of black people.
It's the number one bite. Thing. Yeah, it's we the bite. Number one thing that we fought and for. And I hate every, we fought for it every time.
Bro, I hate it, bro. I hate it so much. And all you need is one little thing that may implicate it. It's like, oh, yeah, he's a fucking racist.
Yeah.
Whatever. Then I look at shit that, you know, the Democrats do. Kamala Harris, bro.
She out there in Atlanta, cooning, shucking and jiving.
Bro. Pandering. She got Meg Thee Stallion, bro. Mm. Meg Thee Stallion was twerking.
I already don't really like Meg. I'm not a Meg person.
It's like...
And I know when that's men say that, then they're like, oh, you don't support
women. Nah, I do like Meg. Meg looked good doing it.
Meg is a good-looking girl, but I don't like Meg. I'm not a big Meg person.
My thing with Meg is, it's like, bro, you went and got her for what?
Yeah.
Who is she for, really? Mm-hmm. Son, the audience watching...
Vote, the black woman vote is so important.
The audience watching, it's like, yo... Like I said, and the reason why I made a distinction between Trump is because, like, yo, Trump has always been like that. For the last 40 years, he's been fucking with black people for real, genuinely.
Trump went and got Amber Rose.
Right. That's him trying to pander, but mm-hmm. he's genuinely always fucked with the black people.
Yeah.
He's always fucked with black people.
Yeah.
Whether it's racist or not, whatever, he fucked with black people. Mm-hmm. This chick don't fuck with white black people, bro. I'm not going to play it on the show because I know how YouTube is. Now you're weaponizing your blackness when you've never acknowledged to be black.
Yeah,
she's always said East Asian.
Yeah, every 4 years she got to come out and be like, hey, look, I got hot sauce in my purse.
She's always, that I was Hillary. she walked out of the versus battle.
Yeah.
Bro, she literally is now black. Mm. And she's always been. You got a black dad, but... She leverages which thing she want to be.
Yeah, that's politics, though.
It's nasty. No, but the thing about it is, black people are so fucking, it's like, yeah, black. Oh, yeah, I'm black today. But you didn't hear what she said last week? Mm-hmm. Why wasn't it that same? How are you able to weaponize? Like, I've never heard Obama say, I'm white. He's 50% white. Mm. He's never said, I'm white. He's never done that.
Yeah. Well, America wouldn't let him do that.
He's never done that. And now she's weaponizing her blackness to pander.
Ooh, back to, now that you brought politics up, what about Candace Owens? She's a female with a podcast that's not about sex or men, and it's popular.
She is, and I love her.
Yeah, I mean, Candace Owens.
I'm glad you said that. There you go. I watch her. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So it doesn't have anything to do. She's good.
Yeah.
There's no sex involved. She's interesting. She's smart. She's knowledgeable. I watch her. So women can do that.
Yeah. Candace Owens.
There you go.
Okay, cool.
I stand corrected.
All right, cool. That's all.
But no, but okay, well, let that be a message to the bitches who I'm talking to then.
Yeah.
You don't have to just talk about it. Be interesting. Candace Owens is interesting as fuck.
They're definitely not sitting around a circle having these conversations.
It's Candace Owens is dolo. Like, she's doing it by herself.
Okay.
But you see how but black people shit on her, though.
Yeah.
They
I feel like black people were coming around to Candace Owens for a second, and then she got, like, real Christian. She's, like, super Catholic right now.
Is she?
Yeah, she's, like shitting on people for, I think she had a whole pod where she was shitting on Amber Rose. Because Amber Rose was like, yeah, I don't know if I'm conservative. I'm definitely Republican.
Well, I think she don't like Amber Rose. Amber Rose is a hoe.
Yeah.
She's a hoe. She's a bad. She had the fucking slut walk. Like,
yeah, and fuck the she's slut saying walk. Her Christian values can't allow her to support
But see, but, like but watch Rose. This. But watch this, though. I like that she can do that. See, because I'm voting for Trump, like I always do. Mm-hmm. But I also called out the party for bringing out Hulk Hogan. That was goofy. Mm-hmm. You see? You have to be able to do that.
Yeah.
Just like I could say that Meg Thee Stallion shit was goofy, that Hulk Hogan shit was goofy.
You voting for Trump even though he's trying to get blanket immunity for police everywhere?
Is that a proven fact? Is he trying to do that? Because yeah. I don't believe that.
I mean, I think he said it on multiple podcasts.
Blanket immunity regardless?
Blanket immunity for all police officers.
But also this, right? I can also not agree with some of the things he do.
Some of the, I mean, that's a dangerous but that's that, agenda but that, that affects it's, both me and
it,
you.
It's still not, well, I don't get in trouble, and neither do you. So it doesn't affect me. It affects niggas who get in trouble. I don't get in trouble, bro. Police don't bother me. I don't think police going to get more brave and start fucking with me because he changed the policy. Like,
right,
I'm still going to continue to live the same way I live.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, black people get scared.
I'm doing real well when it comes to
that. Right. Like, this is the thing, though, son. Black people get scared of these policies. Yeah, because you fucking up, niggas. you know what I mean?
You good until you die.
It doesn't bother me. Like, son, I don't know.
You've never been racially profiled?
100%.
Okay.
Absolutely.
That can happen to anybody. You could be living crime-free.
But watch this, though. We're going to be racially profiled because we are black.
Mm-hmm.
Don't lose yourself in the midst of it. That's what I'm saying. Like, you can be for policy. You can be against policy. But you have to know who you are, right?
Mm-hmm.
I know how to act accordingly in that situation.
Yeah.
I'm not about to be out there fighting and arguing. I'm trying to get home to my family.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, I'm trying to go to my family. Mm-hmm. Nigga, I got lawyer money. Mm-hmm. And I'll put a lawsuit against you.
Mm-hmm.
Period. You got your body cam on. I'm gonna turn my camera on if I feel like that's necessary.
Yeah.
But for the most part, I'm driving my car. What am I? I'm not speeding. I have my seatbelt on. My guns are registered. All of that good shit. How often do you actually come across a gung-ho cop that want to kill somebody, bro?
So wait, because I'm just gonna argue for what the people in the audience or in the Let's comments go. Are gonna say. So you're saying that these black people who have been wrongfully shot or wrongfully murdered did something to provoke these police officers?
No, not all of them. Absolutely not. Most cases, a lot of times they do. Mm. But this is not a protection for the police. But let me say it in my perspective, right? If you are not wearing a uniform and you're not a cop, let's remove cops out of the situation.
Mm-hmm.
And let's just be humans for a second.
Okay.
If a white boy came to me in a threatening manner and he's walking towards my vehicle, I'm blowing his fucking head off, bro. Same thing I would do for a black dude. Anybody coming to me in a threatening manner, I have right to bear arms. I'm licensed to carry. I'm you're done.
Yeah.
Right? We put these labels on certain people because of their position.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So although that cop intention, some cops are ill intent. Some of them, a lot of these motherfuckers are gung-ho. Listen, I'm from New York, son. I'm from the home of the disrespecting police. I done told cops, way more cops to suck my dick than have a good day, officer.
Right.
I'm from that, nigga, where I tell, yo, suck my dick. I'm that guy. I'm from that. But I'm older now, bro. I got a family to think of. You know what I'm saying? I got kids to go home to. So I know a lot of times the way we are, we think about our rights and all that.
Yeah.
Ask yourself, when this cop is coming at you incorrect, did you do anything to provoke the situation to happen?
Right.
Be realistic, bro.
That's accountability.
100%. I always want to say, I saw Dave East on the video a long time ago, right? Dave East was in the hood in Harlem. And I think this is even before they legalized marijuana. Maybe at the time they did. But whatever. You're driving a Rolls Royce through the hood. Weed smoke blown out the car. Y'all drink it in the car. You get pulled over. And you go live on the camera talking about, oh, they harassing us.
What? No, they're doing their job.
You gave them a reason. No. Yeah. Maybe they are harassing you.
Yeah.
But that's how cops are. They want to fuck you up.
Mm-hmm.
If you already have an insight to think that cops, if you a black man who think cops want to kill black people, mm-hmm. why are you giving them a reason to fuck with you?
Right.
That's my thing. If you already think they're like that, then you move different.
Right.
Niggas is moving stupid.
Yeah.
How you driving around with a suspended license, nigga, and no registration on your car?
Yeah, that's fact.
And then you talking about they harassing you. Mm-hmm. I wasn't doing anything. Well, just by chance, no, he ran your plate.
Yeah.
And he saw your shit was suspended. Have your paperwork right at all times. I get, say if a cop does harass me, when he pulls me over, I understand how to hand him my shit. You're getting concealed weapons license. You're getting license and registration. Hands on the steering wheel, camera start to roll. I'm ready for you.
Mm-hmm.
I'm ready for you, bro. If he's some gung-ho dickhead and he wanted to do something, that's all him. I'm not going to join him to where he got a fight. The cop is not going to have a fight, bro, in court with me.
Yeah.
God forbid he's not one of those dudes and do something to me. But in the meantime, I'm doing everything by the book because you gotta be able to tell a story later, bro.
Yeah.
Don't go out like that. That's what I be trying to tell niggas. You want to fight for your rights right now, nigga? Wait, nigga.
Do it in court.
Do it in court, son. Mm-hmm. Like they do. Do it in court, bro. Mm-hmm. That's all I'm saying, son. And but using even talking like this with this much logic, niggas, oh, you're a coon, you're a sellout. Shut your stupid ass up, nigga.
No, this is one of the first times I genuinely agree with everything you're saying. I feel like what you're saying is be responsible and have a little bit of accountability.
Always.
That's it.
Have your shirt. Listen, with everything I told you, and I'm walking around the way I walk around, and I'm moving the way I'm moving. If a cop pulled me over, pulled me out, beat me up, God forbid, shot me or something like that, he 100% was racist and did something to hurt me, bro.
Yeah, yeah.
Because
yeah.
I know I didn't do anything to provoke this shit.
Yeah.
It's just like being in a relationship. Mm-hmm. Anything you do has consequences to it. Don't contribute to the consequences. Mm. That's all I'm saying, son. At all. Don't contribute to it at all. Let him be, if you want to be a racist dickhead, let him be a racist dickhead. Mm. Sit there and take that shit, and later on, nigga, pull up with your lawyer, nigga. Pull up with that lawyer. You're going to win, son.
Yeah.
You're going to win. His body camera's on. Your camera recorded everything. Your paperwork was right. You have no drugs in the car. Your seatbelt was on. You was doing the speed limit. Everything, you did everything by the book. This is all documented information. You're going to win, bro.
Yeah.
Be the coward that go home and tell a story, nigga.
There was recently just a girl who she called the police, and then the nigga
100% a victim. 100% a victim.
And that he was a nasty nigga. He was like, "Yo, I'll shoot the fuck out of you. I'll shoot you in your fucking
and
face."
Did. And he did. And did it. And also, they got it on. Bro, there's no justice in this situation because that woman lost her life.
Right.
Unfortunately, that's the one situation where this motherfucker was looking for a reason. Mm-hmm. I even heard a recording of him being reprimanded by his captain or something like that.
Yeah, he had mad shit on his shit, like multiple
reprimands. Same thing with Derek Chauvin, the dude that killed George Floyd.
Mad reprimands.
Like I said, you're going to get those situations where it's unavoidable. Mm-hmm. But what makes a cop different from the little blood or Crip nigga walking down the street to do something to you? Mm. They're the same person, bro.
Yeah, it's just another gang.
They're the same person.
With a little bit more immunity.
Listen, let me go on record by saying this. I view all police as piece of shit. Mm. I think they are, bro. I don't trust no cops, nigga. I don't deal with them. Mm. I don't call them for nothing. I'll call them if somebody broke in my crib and I wasn't there. Because if I was there, somebody's dying. Mm. I don't trust police. And because I don't trust police, that's why I move the way I move. Mm-hmm. I don't move with trust for the police. I also think there are way more good cops than bad cops.
Sure.
I think there are way more good cops than
bad
cops.
We're on the same page about all this, by the
way. Yeah, bro.
Yeah, yeah.
Same page. But my thing is, if you don't trust somebody, why are you giving those people you don't trust a reason to do something to you?
Yeah, I just don't even give you access to my
life. It's a contradicting argument. You say, oh, cops ain't shit, nigga, fuck the police. Okay, so why are you giving these niggas a reason to talk to you then, bro?
Right.
I don't give them a reason to talk to me because I don't trust them. Mm. Period.
Makes sense to me.
Yeah, man. But anyway, that's enough of the political shit. Let's get into the fun shit, bro. Let's get into the fun shit. So, earlier today... Yesterday, I sent all of you a fucking, you know what? Before we get into it, let's do this real quick. Oh, yeah, I wanted to see this. Yachty said this. Lil Yachty said, Atlanta runs the culture. He said that Atlanta.
Don't let your New York bias get you jammed up.
Bro, culture is a big word.
Yeah, but I feel like I don't agree with that statement, I feel like somebody has the right to say that.
I'm going to take it a step further. He said Atlanta runs the culture in fashion, too. Okay. Let me go and say this real quick, bro. Mm. Nobody is trying to dress like Lil Yachty except Drake. Nobody. Nobody's dressing like that nigga, son. Atlanta has no influence on fashion at all. None. Zero.
What's the Atlanta fashion?
Well, first of all, if you ask anybody who's not from Atlanta, what are they going to say? Come on. What do you think the general consensus is of Atlanta fashion for men?
That's like some gay shit.
Right. Yeah. See?
Yeah.
Right.
Niggas is gay.
That didn't. If that's the thought, how do you run fashion?
Yeah, I mean, fashion is a feminine and homosexual led.
Well,
if,
all right. Well, we're speaking of heterosexual men who are from a hip hop stance.
Oh yeah,
I would think Atlanta stands on their own. They have an Atlanta thing.
Yeah,
I will always and forever, until that changes, give it to New York always, and that's not even because I'm from New York. It's because one, New York is the fashion capital of the world. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of weird shit that, but if you see like. It's certain, I think all, for me personally, I'll put Florida in front of Atlanta. Mm. I think Florida even has their own thing. With nigga Wix,
yeah,
that's a Florida thing.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
100%.
Is hair and fashion synonymous?
Yeah.
Okay.
For when it comes to black people, it is.
Okay.
Because we'll look at another black person like, oh yeah, I'm doing that too. Mm-hmm. I always ask myself, if I was white, how would I do my hair?
Mm-hmm. Comb over part.
I don't know what the fuck I would do with my hair if I was white. But I do know this. When it comes to like, niggas be thinking like, niggas who can't, typically from the hood, who from the hood and they get money, they'll just go to Gucci and I call them mannequin shoppers.
Yeah.
You just wear Gucci, 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 Gucci. That's not fashion, bro.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, you don't even know how to put shit together. Fashion, when I say fashion, I mean, I'm talking about when Jay-Z say, and I don't wear jerseys, I'm 30 plus, give me a fresh Yankees fitted, a nigga, a button up. Mm-hmm. And then everybody do that.
Yeah.
Like, you just said something.
That was also like 15 years ago.
No, I'm just saying something like that.
Yeah, yeah.
So you have
we
certain.
We don't have that.
You have certain errors, right? No, mm-hmm. We do. We have the internet. And the internet dictates, because at one point, when I first came down here, niggas was wearing jean shorts down to their ankles, big giant denim FUBU platinum shorts, mm-hmm. big shirts, classic Reeboks. Mm-hmm. Florida was some of the worst dressed niggas I've seen in my life.
Yeah,
because there was no internet to marry us together. And when I came down here, it was obvious. It was obvious. Oh, you a New York nigga? Mm-hmm. Fitted hats. I had Coogee, like the Coogee knitted sweaters on, mm-hmm. Timberland boots. It was obvious. Now everybody's wearing Timberland boots because the internet kind of dictates fashion. There's no separation. Like, niggas wear Nike Tech sweatsuits. And everybody's doing it in the fucking country, so you don't know where it started at.
Yeah.
But fashion was a regional thing. Like, if I came out here and dissed the nigga, oh, you platinum FUBU bum ass shit, he probably said, yeah, look at your ugly ass sweater. Mm-hmm. Because fashion was a regional thing.
Oh, that makes sense, yeah.
It was regional. It wasn't like, oh, we're all dressing the same.
Yeah.
So when Yachty says that, he's saying that niggas is trying to dress like Atlanta niggas. Nobody, listen, the staple y'all got is gay shit. Like, y'all niggas, listen, bro, the first nigga to wear a dress was Andre 3000.
Who's the first nigga to wear a dress?
That was a rapper, a big rapper that did it.
Yeah.
The Young Thug with the dress, y'all niggas started painting y'all nails. Weird rubber bands in your hair. Y'all niggas, the sheer shirts and all that. These niggas dress like women, bro.
Yeah.
Ain't nobody trying to do that, son.
I don't have an opinion on it. I'm trying to go back to Atlanta, so.
I fuck with Atlanta.
Okay.
But don't say nigga, and Yachty said it of all people.
Yeah.
If Future said that, it would probably get some energy.
I hear you.
Or Migos maybe, yeah. T.I., somebody like that, somebody who got influence.
Relevant.
Yachty ain't, I'm not saying Yachty's definitely not irrelevant, mm-hmm. but ain't nobody fucking paying attention to him.
Yeah.
Drake dresses like him, that weird ass baggy shit he had on the golf course. Mm-hmm. Did you see that?
Yeah.
Bro, why? Because it's in a magazine, niggas say, oh, this is fashion. Like they say the weirdo shit is fashion. That's what it is. I guess it's a type of fashion.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But nobody's doing that, bro.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's like anti-meta.
And then there was one. So, yeah, y'all, it's me. I'm back. I'm Dolo. It's just all me sitting here by my lonesome. Kev had to go. Ray is not here, so it is just me, guys. This is the way it was for 3 years, 2 years. So, feels a little good. I miss my team, but, you know, we got a show to do, right? So, listen. So this is the segment I was talking about. And I wish my team was here to do this with me because I would love their reactions to it too. But just like they got to be like y'all, like the audience, and they got to listen to the goddamn show now. So this segment is the worst I wanted everybody to pick their worst verse they ever heard in their life. All right? So they all sent them in. Jason, me and Jason been talking about this verse for years. Y'all know that's my best friend. Kev gave me his best verse. Y'all heard him say what it was. It was a gutter gutter. He said it already. He shouldn't have said it. You know, we just played it on the show. And then Ray sent hers. So let's start it out without further ado. First, we're going to get into it. It's Ray says her verse, the worst verse she ever heard was Little B verse. Let me go to it real quick. So this is Ray's verse.
Yeah, I do my thing.
So it's Lil B. What is this shit? Now, mind you, Lil B is on my list of one of the worst rappers of all time. Hands down, one of the worst rappers you ever hear in your life. He's definitely in the top five worst rappers of all time. This verse is Grove Street Party Freestyle. I think it's the freestyle. It's Lil B verse. So let's go ahead and listen to this. If we got to go lyric for lyric, let's go. But this is Ray's worst shit she ever heard in her life. So let's go ahead without further ado. And it's Lil B. Let's go.
Yeah, I do my thing, bitch. What's up? Young bass guy came in with the ballers. Iced out chain, bitch. I'm rich on that same shit.
Come on, son. Yeah, this is pretty bad, y'all. Listen, I got to sit through it. Y'all got to sit through it with me. So just, you know what I mean? Let's get it done. Let's get it done, y'all.
55 hoes on my dick, bitch, it's Christmas. Straight west side, Bay Area, bitch, I'll grave them. Pretty boy shit, bass guy from that angle.
This nigga is garbage, bro. Lord have mercy.
On like a cradle and you niggas can't stop me.
South, nothing wrong.
Rich and cocky. Bitches still west side. South, south to Weezy. Young bass guy with that 55 heater. 187,
wow.
Bitch. I pull up to 11, bitch, with that tiny shirt, man.
And
that
wow.
Tiny pants, man. I'm on that bass world and I fuck with cash. Many niggas don't understand.
Nah.
Man, the game like a chain. Man, that
yo, nothing wrong.
But ain't that thing, man, bro, off top. I'm a wolf pack hitter, man. My life
this is
just
crazy.
A painting, and I paint you a picture, man. Think about it.
Nah, I can't do it no more, y'all. Ray, good pick. Good pick. But can I get my, can I get my 59 seconds back? Jesus Christ, this nigga's garbage. I'm glad we ain't got to hear from him no more. I don't know where he at, but whatever he doing, I hope he's staying out the booth. All right, so next is pull up, let's do Kev's. Kev had Gutter Gutter's verse on Bedrock. I think Kev just don't like Gutter Gutter. The verse is trash, but I've heard way worse shit than this. It's actually kind of bearable. You know what I mean? So to me, it wasn't that bad, but if it's Kev's worst, that's his worst. Kev must be listening to some good-ass music because this is really ain't that bad. So let's go ahead and this is a version where it's just his verse. We ain't got to listen to the whole song. And then we're going to get to the good stuff, y'all. So this is Kev's. It's Gutter Gutter's verse, which is only, damn, 25-second verse. Well, thank God we ain't got to sit through this shit for so long. So this is Gutter Gutter's verse on Bedrock. Let's go.
Like the way you walking, if you walking.
My way.
I'm that Red Bull. Now let's fly away.
I was trash.
Let's buy a place with all kind of space. I let you be the judge, and I'm the case.
That was corny.
I'm Gutter Gutter. I put a under. I see me with her. No Stevie Wonder. She don't even wonder, because she knows she bad.
It definitely was garbage. But I've heard way worse. Kev, I think that was a fast pick for you. I don't think you really did your research, bro. Kev, I'm gonna need a different pick from you, son. It wasn't. If that's your worst, then cool. You must be listening to some real good music. Because I've heard way worse. So let's get into Jason. Jason, who is the producer on the show. So in the 90s, that's where you got your real terrible rap at. Because people don't even talk about it. But there was a group back in the 90s called the Fooshnickens. I don't know if y'all remember this, but there's an era of hip-hop where the shit was real cartoony. It was real cartoony bars. It was nasty. It was nasty bars going on back then. It was a creative time in hip-hop where hip-hop was really trying to find a place. It was an era where niggas was just trying out new shit. In this era, it was fun. You know what I mean? But this shit has no replay value. So this is Fuchs Niggas, and the leader of the Fuchs Niggas, who I think who was the leader because he was like the most animated nigga, Chip Fu. It was a song called Breakdown. And me and Jason as kids, we might have even liked this song. But as we started to get older, we started to really analyze this shit. And we was like, yo, what is this nigga talking about? Y'all want to talk about some goofy ass shit? This shit is goofy. Goofy. So I'm gonna play it. It's Chip Fool's verse on. Let me just go right to the verse. I got the timestamp on it. The first verse wasn't that bad. But this song is called Breakdown. If you guys are interested in hearing the whole song, y'all may think this is some real Who Framed Roger Rabbit. Just listen to it, y'all. So this is Jason's pick for his worst verse of all time.
A sound full of spunk, yes, we break it down, cause it's...
All right, so here's the hook. Just be prepared to be bouncing off the walls, cause this nigga's about to be on some cartoon, out of this world shit. So without further ado, we got Chip Fool with Jason's worst verse of all time. Here we go.
What to do, Timbuk 1, Timbuk 2, I can't see a thing like Mr. Magoo, this living in true, stuffy, naughty, nappy, jack in the box, dreadlock, fox, so nah, what's up?
It's just so, it's just all sound effects, it's bad.
Oops, shiver me to my boots. Oh my gosh, oh my dude, shucks. Yo, now I got the hiccups and I rips up many tracks, jump in your holes of facts.
This nigga's a jumping jump. Who's the fats? This nigga is not talking about anything. He's talking about nothing, ladies and gentlemen. He's not talking about nothing right now.
Don't make a sound. I see little rabbit twacks like thunder. And lightning must have frightening. Can't you tell I'm loco? Ooh, they don't know me very well. So I lump some big bruiser with black eyes and stitches. The mad king could be run from rags and the riches. Now my scruples, I lose them. Damn it, I grew from a doodle face that still called me freckles from poof. I got secrets, but I don't know. Like Yoko, I'm oh no, I'm changing visions.
This nigga said like Yoko, I'm oh no. Like Yoko, I'm oh no. What is oh no? Oh no doesn't mean anything. It's her name. I got to run it back a little bit. Cause I want y'all to hear how much nonsense this nigga's talking about. This shit is nonsense. Salute Chip Fool with the Fooch niggas. This shit has no replay value. Y'all niggas, this was goofy. And it's trash. It's really trash. I'm with Jason on this. This is bad.
So call me, I'm Quasimoto, yo, I'll switch up, pick up, with or without the hiccups, cause MCs quickly pick up, then I freaks my foolishness back, out on the microphone, yo, creep it, and I freaks it, pick up.
What's up with the hiccups? Come on, son.
When I fix it with my drunk attack, I make your pips, but now it's back to the lagoon, way up this creek, and don't sleep, when it's time to creep. We roll my deep, and if the ish gets time to think, here comes the 5-6 freak to break it down.
This nigga said, here comes the 5-6 freak. This nigga told the world he was 5'6". So little, did he say he's 5'6"? Yo, being 5'6 is crazy. Sorry to all you short. Being 5'6 is, as a grown man, that's a child. Look at this shit.
Way up this creek and don't sleep. When it's time to creep, we roll my deep. And if the ish gets time to think, here comes the 5-6 flip to break it down.
Nasty fucking work. So that was Jason's worst verse of all time. Chip Fool of the Fooshnickens with Breakdown. Now, here comes my pick. And this is absolutely, to me, the worst verse of all time. Let me find a song. The song is called... Shit, what's it called? The fuck? God damn it. I'm drawing a blank. Show and Proof. Song is called Show and Proof. Now, I'm going to tell you who's on this song, and you would think this is going to be the illest song you've ever heard in your life. This song has Jay-Z, first of all, an unlikely group of guys, and a lot of people don't even know the song is in existence, but it is, and I remember the song as a kid. It's Jay-Z, well, first of all, it's Big Daddy Kane's song. So it's Big Daddy Kane, Jay-Z, Sauce Money, Shaheen the Rugged Child, Old Dirty Bastard, and then another nigga on it. And I believe this is the same Scoop who was Big Daddy Kane's backup dancer. So I guess Kane wanted to give his backup dancer a shot at rapping. Typically, you would let the best verse lead. But Kane had the bright idea to let Scoop lead. And in my opinion, this is the worst verse I've ever heard in my life. The voice, the bars, everything about this verse is it's the worst verse I've ever heard in my life. If you watch the video, the nigga's fit is crazy. The nigga got some One Piece Dickie shit on, dressed like Michael Myers. He got some Michael Myers denim Calcanas shit on. It's nasty. It's huge. It's open. I hope he's okay. I hope he's alive and well. But I will let you know, nigga, in my personal opinion, this is the worst rap verse I've ever heard in my life. And I think that's why nobody ever heard this song. Oh, that's 3.1 million views. The reason why nobody, this song never blew up, because look at this collaboration. Jay-Z, Big Daddy Kane, Old Dirty Bastard, Shaheem, Sauce Money. That is a crazy combination. These are greats. And then Scoob leading the way. Y'all tell me what y'all think, but without further ado, the worst rap verse in history, in my personal opinion, Scoob with his verse on Show and Proof. Here we go.
Hey, laugh now, nigga.
You see what I'm saying? Nigga sound like he rapping like this shit is trash. Trash. Start it over again.
Hey, laugh now, nigga. My man's right behind you. Can't pull the trigger. I don't
Jesus
play.
Christ.
I'm from the hill where shit is real. And I be on your ass like bugs on the windshield.
And I'll be on your ass like bugs on a windshield. Woo! It gets worse. It gets worse, y'all. Listen to this shit.
I cut hand, you still can't get no pause. You could end it with school if we was playing cards.
Nigga said, I couldn't hear you, still couldn't get no punch. You couldn't deal with Scoop if you were playing cards. That shit was so hilarious back in the 90s when niggas still didn't know how to work with words during raps, and they would stretch out a one-syllable word to make it sound hard. This shit was nasty.
Still can't get no pause. You could end it with Scoob if we was playing cards. But if I got beef, then it's time for cold red. My gun is like a hoe, it be taking mad niggas to bed. So
pause, first of all. But I'm going to play this part for y'all, right? And I'm going to let y'all see this shit. This is some foresight that he did that nobody peeped. I peeped it. So, pause for the verse, the ball. The nigga said, my gun is like a, what did he say?
Then it's time for cold red. My gun is like a hoe, it be taking mad niggas to bed.
The nigga said, my gun is like a hoe, it be taking mad niggas to bed. But on that part in particular, when he said, my gun is like a hoe, it be taking mad niggas to bed. At the part where it said, I be taking mad niggas to bed, you have a young Mr. C, rest in peace, shaking his head yes, as he's saying, I be taking mad niggas to bed. What's the odds of that happening? Because as we all know, it was revealed later on that Mr. C took a bunch of niggas to bed. And at that very part, moment, in that verse, he said that. Mr. C is shaking his head. Yes. Nobody knew it at the moment. Some foresight for your ass that I picked up on. So check this out.
Got beef, then it's time for cold red. My gun is like a hoe, it be taking mad niggas to
bed.
So hurry up and skedaddle. Even if you join the army,
you're still cutting battle.
So where you from? England? You somebody great? You burning school? I don't think she might.
Where you from? England, you're so really great. You're burning scoop. I don't think so, mate. First of all, terrible accent. Also, that's not London. That's Australia. Is it? Mate? Could I mate? Yeah, that's Australian. But listen to the accent, y'all. Terrible. Listen.
Army, you still couldn't battle. So where you from? England? You somebody great? You burning school? I don't think she might. Yo, sauce, if you're down with the crew. Get on the mic, I won't just show and prove.
Hey. Oh, my God. The bars are mid and bad at times. But that voice is unbearable. And I think when people heard that verse, that voice in the 90s, although niggas did cartoony shit like that, that verse was so bad that niggas ain't even pay attention to the song. Because like I said, coming up later on the song, Sauce Money, Jay-Z, Shaheem the Rugged Child, Big Daddy Kane, and Old Dirty Bastard. All who eventually became GOATs in their own right. I mean, not Shaheem, but Shaheem, you know, for his time, he was doing his thing. But ODB... You're not skipping the ODB verse. You're not skipping the Jay-Z verse. You're not skipping the Big Daddy Kane verse. And Sauce Money was doing this thing at the time, too. But yeah. Those are all of our picks for the worst verse of all time. That's my worst verse of all time. Scoop on the Show and Prove song. Worst verse of all time. But anyway, guys, the crew's not here. I'm all alone. And I'm going to go ahead and get up out of here. It's going to be a short show. Show is actually really long, if you guys heard it from the beginning. So there will be some pieces and clips with raw audio at the beginning. Just bear with us. For those who are listening, there's a lot of the show you're not going to hear unless you are listening on YouTube. So I suggest you go on YouTube because me and Kev was dropping some bars. So go ahead and check it out. We're trying to get this thing together. We still running, you know, running our own studio. I do need to bring somebody in to help me out with this engineering shit because it does become time consuming just running the pod, editing audio, editing visuals, doing stand-up shows and traveling. Also, running my social media platforms, TikTok, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. I got a lot of shit going on. And then first and foremost, I am a full-time daddy. So I got a lot of shit going on. Being in the gym, working out, all of that. So shit is time consuming. Blair Black entrepreneur shit over here. But anyways, guys, this has been episode 219. It is in the books, and I will see you next week. Ray, get better, and Kev will be here next week with my full team back in full effect for episode 220. But you guys have a wonderful night, and once again, rest in peace to my brother Clifford. Love you, bro. May you fly well.